the king of my heart, be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good. King of my heart, be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good.
Well, good evening, guys, and happy Sunday. I'm so glad that you could again join us for another Sunday evening online. Wow, it's been such a long time. It's such we can't even remember, can we, the last time we met together. But we're excited because things are changing. Tonight, if you're joining us and you don't know us, then you're welcome. My name's Josh, and I'm the assistant pastor here at TFW. And we're going to be carrying on our series tonight, Reimagining the World, the stories Jesus told. And Isaac is going to be sharing one of his favourite parables, which is going to be really great. It was really great last week to hear Joe's testimony, which was really cool. But I'm really excited because this week, if you're part of our Sunday night youth, if you're one of the young people, then hopefully you got one of these. Save the dates, one of the save the dates, because we're excited because we're finally going to be meeting a couple of events together in person. If you're not part of our Sunday night youth, then I'm sorry, you're going to miss out. But if you are, then hopefully this week, one of our leaders or myself, we dropped little packages off at your houses with a few little goodies and save the dates. We're hosting in July and August, and we're really excited. The first one is going to be a barbecue at the church, which is just social. And then the second one, we're going to be doing Limitless online at TFW. And I know it's not the same as the camping experience that we're all desperate to do, but we're going to make it really cool, and it's going to be just a really great time to be able to hang out together. So don't forget, if you can make those events, let us know, let me know. I'm going to be sending more details out in the groups and to your parents as well, just to let them know what's going on. And we'll be making it as COVID secure as possible. It won't be quite what you used to. There'll be some measures in place, but it means we can hang out, so it'll be totally worth it. So let's not be too distracted about what's going on. Let's push in to what Jesus has for us. If you've been tuning in our Sunday mornings, you know Steve's been doing Walking with Jesus, and that's what life is about. It's about walking with him. So I'm just going to pray, and then we're going to start our service because I know it's going to be a good one. Father, we thank you that we can come here together online and just spend time with you. We thank you that you'll speak to us. We thank you that you're just chasing after us, Father. This evening, we turn our eyes and our attention to you. And we thank you that we're going to be able to meet up in person in the next few weeks and in the next month. And we're really excited, Father. And we just pray that you bless that and we just glorify you in it. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Right, guys, so today I'm going to be taking a look at one of Jesus' parables, and the one I want to look at is found in Matthew 20. Now, my little heading, little title calls it "The Labourers in the Vineyard," which I think is a bit of a boring title, right? So I personally like to call it "The Parable of the Generous Landowner." So Jesus tells lots of parables, and it's a big part of his ministry, and they're often misunderstood, because we kind of take them to mean Jesus speaking to us and about us, but actually Jesus tells parables to show us what he's doing and his mission, which was to bring the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, to earth, and that being God's space and our space, heaven and earth, bringing them back together again, like in the beginning, like in the garden, where we're one and walking with God. That was his mission, and these parables give us a commentary, give us illustrations about what his kingdom is like and what he was doing. And just a few verses earlier, we hear Peter asking a question after this dialogue between Jesus and a rich young man. Peter asks this question. He says, "See, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have?" And he's asking Jesus about what reward he's going to get, the disciples are going to get for leaving everything behind, for following him. And Jesus answers him a bit after. He says, "And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first, for the kingdom of heaven is like." And then that goes into our parable. So we see this parable is a continuation of Jesus' answer to Peter's question. So that already in the back of our minds we have that Jesus talking about reward and what it's going to be like in the kingdom of heaven, versus maybe what we think or what the disciples thought. And that's really another big thing that Jesus' parables highlight. They highlight what the kingdom of heaven is like, which is often not what we think, not what we thought it was going to be like. This is God's upside down kingdom. You know, to us, we see lots of Jesus teaching and think like that's not how it works, Jesus. Do you even know like how the world works? That doesn't seem to fit into what I feel, what I'm going through. And actually, you know, these parables are meant to shatter our understanding, because the kingdom of heaven is just so far from what we understand. And this is what Jesus is trying to tell us. This is what he's trying to communicate with us and get across to us using these parables, that we might understand the world a certain way, but he views it a completely different way, especially in this phrase, "Many who are first will be last, and the last first." Like, Jesus is just, you know, going completely against what we see and how we view the world. You know, we see those at the top, you know, they're the first, the greatest, but Jesus says, no, they're going to be the last in the kingdom of heaven, and those at the bottom, the poor, the widows, they're going to be exalted and brought high. They're the first in the kingdom of heaven. And so, you know, this completely goes against what we think, what we know, what the world is like. Jesus said, no, this is what the kingdom of heaven is going to be like. And so this parable is illustrating the upside down, the back to front kingdom of heaven. And we can see that in the context, you know, around this parable. Just a few verses earlier, before the rich young man, Jesus wants the children to come to him. He sees them as important as anyone else. He lays his hands on them. We see it in this dialogue between the rich young man and Jesus saying how hard it is for the rich to get into the kingdom of heaven. You know, we see them as the top guys. They own everything, especially in Jesus's day. They would own all the lands. They would own slaves, own people. And so they would be seen as the right at the top. They owned everything. They controlled everything. The people who had money had power and authority. And that's, you know, usually the same for us today as well. But Jesus is saying how hard it is for them to get into the kingdom of heaven. And later on, after this parable, we see the disciples They're constantly arguing about who's the greatest. This is another example. And Jesus says to them, you know, those who want to be great, if you want to be the greatest, you must become a servant. You must serve those. You must become the lowest and serve other people. That's how to be the greatest. And so to us, that's so upside down. That's so back to front. But that's what Jesus is trying to tell us. That's what he's trying to convey. And we see that throughout Jesus' ministry, you know, these Pharisees and religious leaders, they think they know what is going to happen when Jesus comes, when this Messiah comes. They know the Old Testament and what it says about the coming King and Messiah and the kingdom of heaven, what it's going to look like. And they have this picture in their minds. They think they know. But actually Jesus says, you know nothing. You think it's going to be like this, but actually it's the complete opposite. And it's like this, the first will be last, and the last first. And that angers the Pharisees, this angers these religious leaders, which ends, you know, which leads them to kill Jesus, because it's not what they expected, it's not what they thought. And, you know, we have to be careful about ourselves as well, that we don't limit God to our understanding, to what we think he's going to be like, to what we think he's going to do or give us or wants us to do, that we don't limit him to what we think we know and what we think we understand. And that's kind of the whole aim of this parable, but also Jesus's whole ministry and his parables, to shatter, you know, our understanding, our mindset, how we view the world, and to see things how he views it, and that's what we get through this parable. It says, now when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more. These workers had worked 12 hours through the scorching heat of the day, and yet they still received the same as everyone else. Like, that was so unfair of this master to give them what everyone else had got, when they'd done the most work, they'd worked the hardest, they deserved more, right? That's what we think, and that's what the world says. You know, it says you get out what you put in. The harder you work, the more you work, the more you will get out, the more you deserve, the more you will earn. But actually Jesus confronts that, and he says that's not what it's like in the kingdom of heaven. He said it's not going to be like what you think, it's not going to be like what the world says. And actually you will get what you're given. You know, the master says, I choose to give to this last worker as I give to you. They get what they're given. These first, who got paid first, they receive so much more than they expected. And those who followed, the ones who had worked the hardest, they thought they would receive more, they expected more, they were calculating, working out based on the others what they were going to get, and then they only received the same as everyone else. And God gives differently to how we view giving, to how we view reward, to how we view working. You know, there's no formula in the kingdom of heaven. We can't work it out, we can't calculate it, because God gives out of who he is, not out of who we are. You know, we think because we've worked so hard, but because we've done A, B and C, that we're going to get X, Y and Z. And that's what the world tells us, that's how we view reality. But actually Jesus tells us in this parable that that's not how he views reality, and that the kingdom of heaven, God's kingdom, is going to be different from that, that God is going to give us out of his goodness, out of his generosity, out of who he is, regardless of what we've done, regardless of how hard we've worked, how much we've done, regardless of who we are, he is going to give out of himself and out of who he is. And so that, you know, that confronts us, that confronts me, and then I have a choice to say, you know what, God, I don't get this, I don't understand this. This is so confusing to me, and you know, it makes me angry in a way, because I think I deserve this, and I've worked hard, and you know, why wouldn't I deserve it? but we have to trust God. We have to look at his promises and who he is. You know, we know that he is a good father, that he loves to give to his children. That's us. We are his children. That he loves to give, that he loves to be generous, and that he's going to give out of that, out of who he is, out of his goodness, out of his generosity. And so we have a choice to trust him and say, God, I don't understand this. I don't get the kingdom of heaven. It doesn't make sense to me. But I know that you are good. I know that you are faithful, that you're always with me. And I know that you will give me everything I need, and even more than we need. God says that he will give us abundance, so much more than we need. You know, it might not be what we think we need. It might not be what we thought we were going to get. But we can trust him because he's always good, and he will always give generously as we love him and as we trust him.
Staring at a mountain, thought I had already climbed. The weight of my mistakes hold me down like I'm paralyzed. Yeah. How many times have I asked for grace? Standing in the same broken place. I'll give you every good reason to walk away. But somehow you choose me. Here to catch me every time. I thought I was unlovable till you told this heart of mine. Yeah, I'm worth more than my past mistakes. I'm never too far gone to say. I've given you every good reason to walk away, but somehow you choose me.
Over and over again.